Carl Ethan Ackerley would no longer recognize the Virungas. All these volcanic hills that used to be covered in forest have been cleared of their vegetation. Carl Ethan Ackerley was an American who came to this region in 1921 to carry on his strange trade. He was a trader in wild animals. Ackerley had a very special order from the American Museum, and this was the only place he could find the required article. This zone of extinct volcanoes in the east of the Congo was the only place in the world where mountain gorillas could still be found. Ackerley captured four of these great apes, then had second thoughts about depriving them of their freedom. His encounter with the gorillas was to change his life. Ackerley became a fierce opponent of hunting and fought tooth and nail to protect the gorillas. In those days, the country was a Belgian colony under the authority of King Albert. Ackerley lobbied the king to save the great apes. In 1925, the area was officially declared a national park. When Ackerley died a year later, his wish was to be buried here. The king became a fervent defender of the park, which bore his name. In a few years, Albert Park became the reference of the tropical world in terms of environmental protection. At the same time, it covered the whole mountain range. In 1960, the surface of the park was drastically reduced. Today, it covers barely 50 square miles. It does its best to protect the last surviving gorillas. There are 300 or 400 of them living in family groups of 2 to 30 individuals. It's increasingly common nowadays to see the gorillas come down out of what remains of the forest and go foraging in the farmlands. The family follows its leader, a silverback, an adult male over 15 years old who weighs around 440 pounds. Since most of their original territory has been cleared for farming, the gorillas are obliged to compensate by raiding the maize fields. Gorillas are a herbivorous species. They eat more than 100 varieties of plants and occasionally add some insects to their diet. For the gorillas, maize is a feast fit for a king. The local farmers look helplessly on. Their field is on the edge of the park, but inside the boundary. When the gorillas have finished, the guards move in to take stock of the damage done and explain once again that the park boundaries must be respected and the great apes protected. Not an easy idea to drive home. The local people see only one advantage in the park. The gorillas attract visitors, and the visitors provide a few families with a living. The national park straddles two countries. On the Rwandan side, it's called the Volcano Park. And on the Congolese side, the Virunga Park. A small infrastructure has been built to house the few hundred visitors who come from all over the world every year to admire the gorillas. The comfort is basic, but visiting the gorillas is a luxury in itself. The license to see them close up is very expensive. A group of gorillas has been spotted 5 or 6 hours trek away. The visitors leave in small groups, never more than one group a day. As the group approaches, this family of gorillas moves a few yards away, but they soon go back to what they were doing. This group is one of the few families that have been gradually accustomed to the presence of human beings. The purists disapprove of this contact with the gorillas. But the scientists who are carrying on the work of Diane Fossey believe that this is the only way to save the last of the great apes. All this coming and going can deter would-be poachers. Gorillas are regularly massacred all the same, for their skulls, their hands, which are made into ashtrays, and their young, which are sold to zoos. The fate of these survivors remains uncertain. The visits are frequently suspended, and the park temporarily closed. The volcano park, which was the first in Africa to have the status of a national park, is certainly one of the most difficult to manage today. It's in the heart of a region torn by war and genocide. What happens to the gorillas is the least of people's worries. They're too concerned for their own survival. All over Africa, you can see smoke curling up from the hills where people are clearing land. The African continent is still peopled essentially by farmers, always in search of land to farm. For them, a park, a reserve, a protected area is land confiscated from them. It's hard to make them respect the boundaries and obey the rules. This herd, driven by pearl herdsmen, is crossing the W National Park in Niger illegally. The intrusion may look harmless, but the consequences can be tragic. In 1981, cows brought an epidemic of cattle plague into the park, and it spread to the wild animals. The whole buffalo population was wiped out. The W Park is located in West Africa. It's part of a vast protected area of 5 million acres that straddles the borders of Burkina Faso, Benin, and Niger. Each country has its national park, in a region which is one of the poorest in Africa. This hippopotamus is caught up in a net laid by villagers in a small lake in the Ali National Park in Burkina Faso. Fishing is prohibited there, of course. On the edge of the park, small-scale poaching is an everyday occurrence, a simple way of improving the staple diet. Every morning, the villages resound with the beat of the women pounding millet, always to prepare the same meal, a sort of gruel that fills the belly but is totally devoid of protein content. People here don't eat the pigs or poultry they raise. They're their only wealth, the only thing they can exchange at the market for a little money. When you smell meat cooking in the pots, the odds are that it's bushmeat from the park. Gazelles and other small bush animals are the main victims of this subsistence poaching. It's rarely severely punished. The game wardens often share the pickings when they don't actually take part in the trapping. There are fewer and fewer animals in the Ali Park. The poachers have driven them across the Penjari. The Penjari is the river in the south of Burkina Faso which marks the border with Benin. This wooden bridge takes you into a different country, and also into a different national park. The river has given its name to the protected area. The landscapes are the same as in Ali, but a few miles away in the Penjari National Park, everything is different. Here, the roads are well maintained. They've been covered with laterite, which makes them usable much longer in the dry season. The quality of the road says much about the quality of a park and about its financial means. As the state of the roads deteriorates rapidly, they have to be kept under constant surveillance and repaired whenever necessary. This is a good indicator of the quality of the work done by the management and the wardens. When everything is working as it should and the animals are effectively protected, everything is possible. A fine elephant population in a park in West Africa, for example, a part of the continent where most of the elephant population has been massacred. The great Abyssinian hornbill is about the size of a large turkey. They're quite rare in this part of Africa, but you often see them in the Penjari Park. The lake was dug by man to provide the animals with water even in the dry season, and so to keep them where they would be easy to observe. Nothing is left to chance, and the results are there for all to see. The Penjari is no doubt one of the last places in the whole of West Africa where the great wild species of Africa are still to be found. Almost everywhere else on this part of the continent, protected or not, the animals have been massacred. Uncontrolled hunting and state poaching have done irreparable damage with an easy conscience. There was an illusion of profusion, of endless resources. They said the rivers were infested with crocodiles and slaughtered them. It was in the public interest, they said. It was certainly lucrative. Africa is a victim of the generosity of its nature, of the excesses of its climate cycles, which make whole expanses of its territory uninhabitable or inaccessible in certain seasons. The more inhospitable and impenetrable the continent is, the more it protects its barbarous warlords, the poachers. The real ones, those who hunt not for food for themselves, but to order. Unfortunately for the animals, they're the best trackers in the land. No tracks, no smells have any secrets for them. They're prepared to face any hardship to track down their prey, whatever their clients want. As the last animals are in the nature reserves, that's where they go to hunt them. For years, in the Tarangire National Park in Tanzania, the hollow trunks of the baobabs served as a refuge for elephant killers. Today, the rhinoceros is number one on the poacher's prize list. Even Kenya, where the rangers are authorized to shoot poachers on sight, is incapable of effectively protecting its rhinos in their vast natural habitat. In 1970, there were still 20,000 black rhinos. 15 years later, there were fewer than 500 left. Not even enough to satisfy the annual demand for rhinoceros horn in Yemen alone. To avoid the disappearance of the species in the short term, Kenya decided in 1985 to count the remaining rhinos and move some of them to safe reserves, much smaller parks, which were easier to supervise. The Nakuru National Park fitted the bill. The park is located in the Rift Valley, right in the heart of Kenya. The protected area covers 80 square miles on the shores of Lake Nakuru. Initially, the site was classified as a bird sanctuary, the first in East Africa. Then mammals, too, took advantage of the peace and quiet there. The national park is home to the Rothschild giraffe, a rare species recognizable by the dark star patterns on its patches. These giraffes have virtually disappeared from the rest of the country, but they're perfectly at home here in Nakuru. It's here on the shores of the lake traditionally swarming with flamingos that the Kenyan authorities decided to create the first rhinoceros sanctuary, with one aim in mind: maximum security. In theory, the region is safe, But this time it's not a matter of protecting buffaloes, antelopes, or birds. The value of a rhinoceros horn is so exorbitant that newcomers are coveted almost before they arrive. The territory destined to house the rhinos was fenced off with 50 miles of fencing. 10,000 fence posts and 550 miles of wire were used, and the whole fence is electrified. Once the site was ready, they brought the rhinos in from different parts of the country, black rhinos and white ones, to populate the sanctuary. Many of these animals came from private reserves or ranches, which had anticipated the disappearance of the species and taken preventive action while there was still time. Since the first rhinos were released, none have been lost to poachers. There are now about 50 rhinos in Nakuru. The experiment is an undeniable success, but it also reflects a sad reality. 100 years ago, the rhinos' territory here covered over 100,000 square miles. Today, for their security, they have to be confined to an area 1,000 times smaller. In the south of the continent, the strategy for preserving the rhinoceros is different. They're trying to protect them while leaving them in their vast original habitat. But the rhinos have to pay a high price for their survival. First, they're captured, then their horns are amputated. In this part of Africa, the conservationists believe that removing the rhino's horns can save their lives. The idea is that without their horns, the rhinos are worthless to poachers. The horns are relatively easy to ablate. They're just a mass of keratin which is not attached to the skull. But capturing and immobilizing the animals is a costly business. Ablation of the horn is a lesser evil, a mutilation practiced reluctantly. After all, a rhino with no horn is better than no rhino at all. In actual fact, this operation does not really deter the poachers. To avoid tracking the same animal down twice for nothing, they shoot the hornless rhinos too. In Zimbabwe, 90 out of 100 rhinos killed by poachers in 1993 had had their horns removed. As a result, here too, they're reverting to the only method that really seems to give results, reintroducing the animals into well-protected parks. After a period of acclimatization in an enclosure, this animal will be released in the Etosha National Park in the north of Namibia. In spite of poaching, Namibia has the third largest population of black rhinos in the world, but the white variety has disappeared. This one had to be brought from a long way away. A few weeks ago, it was living in a zoo in Germany. It was born in captivity and has never lived in the wild. In a few days' time, this rhinoceros will be free, released into the vast expanse of Africa's largest national park. The Etosha National Park is the largest reserve in Africa and the fourth largest in the world. A few dozen rangers and scientists have more than 8,500 square miles to supervise. To make it possible to follow the movements of the animals in such a large area, some of them have been equipped with transmitters that make them easy to detect on the scanner. A quarter of the area of the park is occupied by the flats, an immense salt wasteland 75 miles long and 30 miles wide and 12 million years old. It's a former lake that gradually dried into an expanse of dry clay covered with salt. The natives called it Etosha, which in their dialect means the great white expanse of dry water. When the first white settlers discovered this site in the middle of the last century, they were amazed at the number of animals that lived on the edge of the flats. One of them commented, "If you opened all the menageries of the world, it would be nothing compared to what I've seen here today." The environment seems hostile, but in fact the water table surfaces here and there all around the edge of the salt flats, and the animals find water there even in the height of the dry season. With such a concentration of animals, Etosha has become one of the major attractions in Namibia, with tens of thousands of visitors every year. As in almost all the national parks in Africa, the rules are very strict. You're not allowed to get out of your car, and there's a speed limit, not only for reasons of safety, but to protect the animals and vegetation from the dust. Visitors have to be back at one of the three camps in the park before sunset, and no human presence must disturb the great plains of Etosha before sunrise. Thank you. 114 species of mammals and 340 different types of bird have been sighted here, from the ostrich to the little yellow-billed calao. To make it easier to observe the animals, waterholes have been bored at strategic points. In the dry season, they inevitably attract elephants, which drink huge quantities of fresh water every day. The elephants of Etosha are reputed to be the largest in Africa, but their tusks are surprisingly small. This is explained by a lack of mineral salts and by wear and tear. The elephants use their tusks as tools to dig up roots, for example. Artificial means are used to bring the animals to where the tourists are. Although these elephants are perfectly free to roam over thousands of square miles, the spectacle is reminiscent of a zoo. Tourism brings foreign currency, and foreign currency brings the wherewithal to supervise and manage the park effectively. Etosha has about 2,000 giraffes. They're not an endangered species, but the discovery of a corpse is taken very seriously. What they fear most here is an epidemic. Etosha suffered an ecological disaster at the end of the last century. At the time, Namibia was called Southwest Africa. It was a German colony. An epidemic broke out among the herds of wild animals, and the people feared that it would spread to their livestock. For fear of a general epidemic in the domestic livestock, the German cavalry slaughtered tens of thousands of suspect animals with their machine guns. Samples are taken to make sure that the giraffe was not killed by anthrax, a deadly bacterial disease that attacks 14 species of herbivores, including elephants and zebras. The disease is extremely contagious, and one of the laboratories in the park works on it non-stop, developing vaccination campaigns, among other things. By taking these steps to protect the animal's health, man is deviating somewhat from the fundamental principle of the parks, even if nature is basically still left to itself. Etosha has a research center in the heart of the park. Its role is to study how the characteristics, the populations, and the behavior of the species evolve. There are only a few thousand blue gnus left in Etosha. In less than a century, their number has decreased dramatically all over southern Africa, and nobody really knows why. One possibility is that the species is on the wane because it can no longer make its traditional migration. When it was founded in 1907, Etosha was called Game Reserve No. 2. The protected area stretched right to the sea, to the shores of the Skeleton Coast. 300 miles from west to east, it was the largest animal reserve in the world. An expanse so vast that every species, every herd, was free to come and go wherever instinct or nature might lead it. In 1970, the protected area was divided by four and enclosed by an iron curtain, hundreds of miles long. All over southern Africa, the animals are hemmed in by barriers erected by men to preserve their livestock, their fields, and their homes. Under the pressure of human activities, the animals change their habits, their behavior. They leave their favorite regions for less hospitable but more peaceful ones, where man lets them have the run of areas which are no good to him. This savanna land in the northwest of Zimbabwe was no use to anybody. Too dry, too hot, too sandy. Impossible to farm. We're on the edge of the Kalahari Desert. The zone was declared a national park in 1929. It was named after a local tribal chief, Hwange. Most of the animals deserted the area in the dry season. Water was too scarce. Then one day the bush began to throb with a strange sound, and the animals stayed, and more animals came. A whole battery of pumps had been installed to pump water from under the ground to fill around 60 artificial watering holes. Now that there was water in all seasons, many species made this their permanent home. Today, the park has one of the densest concentrations of animals in Africa. It's home to one of the most handsome antelopes, the sable antelope. In 1980, when Zimbabwe won its independence, the authorities considered that running the park was not a priority. The money ran out, maintenance was neglected, and the pumps broke down one after the other. The watering holes dried up, and many animals left the area. Although there were fewer animals and they were harder to observe, the noise of the pumps gave way to the singing of birds, and the grasslands of Hwange recovered some of their peace and serenity. Gradually, one by one, the pumps were repaired. As Hwange is very close to the Victoria Falls, it was tempting and easy to drain off some of the financial benefits of the tourism there. The artificial watering holes have changed the park's natural ecosystem and disrupted the natural balance of the animal populations. The number of elephants has soared to more than 25,000 in an area of 6,000 square miles. One third of all the elephants of Zimbabwe live here. The elephants regularly wander out of the park and cross the border into the Shobe National Park in neighboring Botswana. In the 1930s, Botswana was still called Bechuana Land, and nobody but elephant hunters ever went there. Word spread through the grapevine that there was no finer place to shoot elephants, It was not until 1961 that this area became a nature reserve, and then a few years later, a national park. It takes its name from the river that runs along the northern border of the protected area. This mighty river flows down from the north of Angola, where it draws its life from the rains that constantly fall on the high plateaus. Its banks attract a host of animals, but above all, it's the realm of the elephant. The park now has almost 70,000 elephants, more than one-tenth of all the elephants in Africa. There are three times as many elephants here as in Hwange, but the area is smaller. The effect of overpopulation is accentuated by the uneven distribution of the animals. The elephant population is unevenly spread over the 4,000 square miles of the park. Most of them, particularly the groups of females with their young, are concentrated along the banks of the river. They hardly ever leave the river banks. It makes life so much easier for an elephant to have a constant supply of water within easy reach of its trunk. The water of the Shobi River flows cool and clear, just as they like it, and all year round. What more could they want? The park is a real paradise for these animals, protecting them from drought and from poachers. One unmistakable sign is that the elephant population increases by 5% every year. As it happens, it's the health of the elephant population that worries the park managers. As soon as you leave the immediate vicinity of the banks of the Shobe, the savannah looks in places like a lunar desert. The elephants have been through here, devouring everything in their path. They literally cleaned out the landscape. Elephants like to eat fruit and grass, but they also eat branches, bark, and foliage. You can't be too fussy when you need a daily intake of 300 or 400 kilograms of vegetation. It's not difficult to work it out. The elephants in the Shobe Park eat 10,000 tons of vegetation every day. There are four times as many elephants here as the land can really feed. They overexploit the land they're allowed to live on, and when they go further afield, their presence is undesirable. Botswana has set aside one-fifth of its land for its wild animals. The remaining four-fifths are strictly reserved for human activities. The villagers who live on the edge of the park respect its boundaries, but they're worried about the size of the elephant population. They're worried for their homes, for their herds and their crops, that the elephants will try to enlarge their territory. The voices of the herdsmen and the farmers join those of the specialists who recommend culling the elephants, like they do in neighbouring South Africa or Zimbabwe. Here, this would mean killing 2,000 or 3,000 every year. Of course, they could dig watering holes to encourage the elephants to leave the riverbanks. They could also give some of the elephants to those countries of Africa which have none. But nobody really takes that possibility seriously. It would be far too costly, unthinkable. The authorities in Botswana are reluctant to kill the elephants. How can they explain to the tourists that there are too many elephants? How can they break the spell? Admit that something has to be done, that you have to go against nature, keep it under control. The timeless Africa, the virgin continent they think they see, no longer exists. And they are responsible, like it or not. Wherever trails are laid so that they can see the animals close up, some of the truth of the expression nature reserve disappears. But without the foreign currency tourism brings in, not a single country in Africa would have been able to preserve its wildlife. To manage a protected zone is to manage a paradox. There is one park where all the difficulties of maintaining a balance between contradictory aims and realities are concentrated. It lies in Kenya, at the foot of Mount Kilimanjaro. Wildlife has always been more plentiful there than anywhere else in East Africa. Hardly surprising, it's Maasai country. The Maasai only hunt in cases of extreme necessity, and they do not tolerate others hunting on their land. So wherever the Maasai lived, the game was naturally protected. This magic place is called Empusel, which in the Maasai language means barren plain or salty dust. All over the world, Empusel is known as Amboseli, one of the most famous national parks in the world, a sort of symbol of the African park, but also of the difficulties encountered there. It's a very small area, barely a few dozen square miles. It was not easy to turn it into a haven for animals. First, the Maasai and their herds had to be moved out. Under duress, the Maasai finally left the land they were so attached to. And then they took revenge by killing rhinos. They killed all the rhinos in the area, and to make sure there was no mistake about their motives, they left their horns intact. Eventually, their land was returned to them, or rather, the marshland was exchanged for other land. Peace was restored. The Amboseli Park is on the program of every Kenyan safari. It has everything going for it. A safe area, easy access, not too far from Nairobi, and large numbers of animals in a small area. But the future is uncertain. There are too many animals for the ecosystem, too many tourists for the animals. The Amboseli Park lives from one day to the next, but nobody knows what the future holds. At the foot of Mount Kilimanjaro, for the time being, the illusion remains intact.